Hey guys, this is Tim from Tim's Electronics Lab and welcome back to a new video. Now, as a result of me graduating my bachelor, I gave myself a little present. Here it is. I'm going to unbox it with you and we're going to take a look at it. We're going to discuss some various little things in it. I'm going to take it apart, since that's of course everybody wants. So, and I'm very excited about it. So, it just arrived. I ordered it, I think, on Wednesday. It's now Saturday. So, yeah, rather quickly, actually. Oh, and it's upside down. I didn't even need a knife. Wow, improved packaging this. With the side, it's a blank box. Well, not entirely blank. There's one little barcode. Here it is. And as you might be able to guess, if you're a little bit into electronics, you might already have recognized the branding. It's a signal generator. Wow, it's tiny, man. It's really tiny. Oh, the box is still heavy. What's inside the... The box at this point is heavier than the signal generator itself. What's this? Oh, loads of cables. Yeah, this is a European cable. I think they call it EC. AEC. EEC. Not sure. They provide two BNC to alligator clips and one BNC to BNC. And a USB. Cable, really nice and really handy, and that's everything that's in the box. So let's get the box at my desk and let's unwrap this thing because I'm very excited about it. Now I've got this signal generator, and yeah, as you can see, it's pretty analog. Actually, it's almost completely analog except for the frequency. You can set that by pushing the buttons. But the main problem that I'm having with this is that the signal is very unstable. If you push here or push there or do something over here, then the output waveform goes all over the place. And you can't fine-tune the amplitude and the offset. So when you need a 2.6 volt peak-to-peak signal, you need to measure it with your scope. And then triple check it, otherwise your circuit will blow. And if you accidentally bump it, it already shifted by 1 volt. Because this has an output range of, I think, 0 to 30 volts or 0 to 20 volts. Which is quite a lot. And you don't want 20 volts on a 2 volt capable circuit. So, let's end with this. I'm going to show you a trick that you can use to connect this to your oscilloscope. So first let's cut open the seal so we can unbox it. Really nice. It's light. It's really light. Oh, I was expecting that they put a plastic thing over the screen. And there's a little fingerprint on it. Well, it's not touchscreen, so. Yeah, knob feels okay. I'd rather have it a little bit bigger, but. Oh wow, those buttons, damn, they really need to press them. They're not like, look, I'm pressing, but I think it's double the force that you have with an oscilloscope, but that's cool, that's really cool. So you've got two outputs, let me put it like this, you've got two outputs, and one counter input, yeah, that's used to count frequencies and all that stuff. This is the 14-bit 60 megahertz version. Is it written somewhere on the thing, actually? It's the, yeah, 60M, 60 megahertz. Now, I'm not sure if it's only a software trick. I think there are 20, 30, 50, and 60 megahertz. Not sure if the difference between those variants is only a software trick or it's actual hardware difference. But it might be an interesting video. Ooh. What? Oh. Oh, this is... You need to pull them out and then you can twist them. Oh, this is really cool. Now you're sure that the thing won't fall down on you. I'm not sure if I like it. I'd rather have this to be completely removable. Maybe it's completely... Oh, never mind. I was about to say, I want it at the top. And I didn't see a way of doing that, but it's, yeah. Pretty cool, you can set it down like this with this, without the thing falling down. There are no rubber feet on the bottom. That's a little bit of a downside, because I'm wondering if this will stay put on my oscilloscope. I don't think it will, so might need a little fix here and there. So let's take a look at the back. Now we've got a trigger input, a synchronization thing. Synchronization out, synchronization in. I think that's used to synchronize multiple devices, multiple of the same devices. And you can also, I think you can also connect this to your oscilloscope's trigger in at the back. And then they will all sync up. But I'm not sure, I don't think my oscilloscope has a trigger input at the back. No, some scopes do. And you can use this as an output for your scope's input. TTL, serial communication. Learn more about that in, I think, the next video. Yeah, I'm not going to cover it in this video. I'll probably cover it in the next video. So stay tuned on my channel, because it's very exciting. USB, now there's a USB to serial converter, which is basically used to talk to the CPU. And you can program various functions inside this thing. So, a fan that's unpopulated. A nice switch with the matching power socket. At the bottom, yeah, there's a sticker. And at the front, yeah, it's really two channel. BNC's feel quite good, actually. So I suggest we power it up and then take a look at what we need to fix, because we need to fix something right away. So, put it in here. And unwrap the power cable. Now it's not long, it's not the shortest, it's not the longest. I think it's about 1.5 meters. Does it say on the, no it doesn't. I think it's about 1.5 meters. Oh, it's whoa, it's a good power socket. Ah. Always good to, oh, version 3.1. Now they're both on already. Cool. Oh, the screen is really, it's a basic screen, but it shows what's needed and it shows it very well in my opinion. Now it's really crisp and really sharp. So that's cool. So let me output a sine wave. Now I don't think that this will be the final setup, but let's power on the scope and check the signals out. Now I'm going to use the BNC to BNC, and they only supplied one, but that's no problem because I've got another one myself. So let's grab that real quick. They didn't supply the same cable. It's another cable. Usually the cables are identical. Come on. Usually the cables are identical, but these are a little bit different. It's connected to channel 2 to see if changing things on channel 1 has any impact on channel 2. Check my scope settings. Yeah. So on channel 1, we've got a sine wave with a zero frequency. I think that's 10. Yeah, there you go. So this should be 10 hertz, I think. Let's trigger. Oh, 10 kilohertz. You can also use the buttons over here. Oh, you can see it. You can also use the buttons over here to switch the actual digit that you're changing. So that's really nice. So let's do a frequency of this was 10 kilohertz, so this is 1 hertz. Oh, this is 10 hertz. Yeah. This is 10 hertz, so this is 1 hertz. Let's do rolling. Yeah, this is 1 hertz. Let's increase it to 100 hertz. Disable rolling. Zoom in a little, get the full bandwidth, fine adjustment. It's always important because you miss out resolution if you don't adjust it to the full amplitude. Okay. Oh, why did it jump back? Zoom in, because the signal looks really clear, really crisp. So that's alright, let's turn on channel 2. This is also a sine wave of 100 hertz. Oh, no, this is quicker. This is not, oh, this is 10 kilohertz. Oh, they did influence each other. So it doesn't stay synchronized. That's a little bit of a shame. Now let me fine adjust this as well. I'm having a 5 volt peak to peak. And this is RMS, measure type, peak to peak. Yeah, oh, it's a little bit above 5 volts. We're standing to a little bit, yeah, that's 5 volts, so it's a little bit above 5 volts actually. This is rather interesting. Now let's try the offset. Push offset. Oh yeah. Yeah, because, yeah, it basically does the offset. That's cool. So cool, and also you can do a sweep, you can do a start frequency, end frequency, and a length. Now this is on channel 1, press OK. Oh, okay, let's get rid of this thing, get rid of channel 1, Why is it? Come on, focus a little bit better, man. Oh, the trigger is not trigger alternating. So why do I want it back on the bench? Well, there's a problem with this thing, and let me show it to you. Now, please beware that this could potentially be very dangerous. So I'm going to show it to you, so you don't have to do this. First thing we do is we test for continuity on the BNC probes. And you can see they're all connected. Front ones are connected, everything is connected. We've got a nice pinout, the ground over here. So everything is connected to the ground, which is how it's supposed to be. Now we've got a mains wire over here with 230 volts AC running over it. And if I switch it on, you can see that on my multimeter. If we take this apart, which they provide a nice how-to one in their documentation set, we can see that issue, and we can also see another issue that we're going to fix. Now there's a screw under here. I was about to say this was under warranty, but I'm not sure if there's even any warranty on it. So let's take it apart. Here's another bit for this. This is better. Now these are all self-tappers, so, and you can get what makes it a lot easier, one of these, because there are clips over here. Over here. And there's one over here at the other side. Doesn't really like to be taken apart, but eventually we'll get there. There you go. This is one. So there are two at the top and two at the side. And just slide it in there, push it, and pull a little out a little bit. Oh, that one's already loose. Nice. So, ah, there you go. So, we do the same for the front side. An issue right now because I'm able to slide this in. I've got another tool for a job. It's this one. There you go. Quite nice. Cool. So front panel, let's do it this way. Now you should be able, yeah, there you go, should be able to lift it off. Now, here's the power source. Oh, you can remove it. Look. Ta-da. Now, here's the power supply. And if we zoom in, ooh, this way. we can see the IEC connector over here with the mains wiring, the toggle switch bottom at the top, and over here we can see the mains wiring. Well, the problem is that this one, the Erling strap, is not a mains rated cable. It's a little bit too thin to handle 230 volts AC, and if we measure the continuity, this is what's used as a ground. So this is connected to the ground of the device. And as we saw before, there was a voltage of, well, 50 to 230 volts AC between one of the faces, the neutral and the, or the live and the ground. So live and earth. That's not good. So in order to fix that, it's rather simple. You actually put a wire between the, or a resistor between the earth strap and the connector. A resistor of around 10 kilo ohms. And then it's fixed. Well, what we're also going to fix, oh, that was not supposed to happen. We're also going to use a proper earthing strap for connecting the earth wire to the PCB, because this is by far not mains rated, and that plug is supposed to save your life in the event of everything going wrong. So it's time to grab our soldering iron and fix this thing. So you should know how to properly solder. So I won't explain in detail what I'm doing, but I will use my solder fume sucker, which you can view on my channel how I created it. It's open source, there's no source code, but you can build it yourself as well. So now we actually need to remove the wire from the connector. You can do that by using a very thin tweezer or a screwdriver, a flathead screwdriver, and push the connector, and then it will eventually come out. So, wow, there's barely any wire sticking in there. Now, there are plenty of crimping tools that you could use to crimp this connector onto the wire, but I don't have them, so I'll do it. Now, just for extra protection, I'd like to apply some solder. So we know that there's a secure connection between the connector and the earthing wire. Like this. So now, let's add a heat shrink. Nice matching green color. Earth wire prepared. Let's check if it will fit inside the connector, since, well, that's what we want. Should be this way. Well, it doesn't hold down, but it does hold down once the once you put it over the pin, 10 kilo ohm resistor. We're going to put it between the earthing wire and the plug. So twist it around a few times. And then grab your soldering iron. Make sure there's a good layer of solder around the leads of the resistor. like so. Wait for it to cool down, because I can see the fumes and the heat coming off it. And in the meanwhile, let's desolder the mains or the earthen. Well, then went really quickly. Also, don't like these being naked. So let's shove the heat shrink over the resistor like such. I only do it over the leads, because then you're still able to see the resistor and you still know it's there. So we're out of luck with the small green heat shrinks. They're, I'm out of stock. So this is also going to work out, I hope. So I suggest that you actually wrap the resistor lead through the hole in the connector a couple of times. So you get a good solid contact. You might want to use a tweezer for that. Oh, here it is. Turn off. That could make it a little bit. Oh, I didn't. Oh wait, I can shove everything over it. Now, if you've got a little bit of a tinier or smaller heat shrink, then you should put on the heat shrink first before you do this, of course. I've got a bigger heat shrink, so, and I just forgot it, to be honest, like this. So yeah, cool. So that's done. Now cover it with solder. Cover it properly with, oh, with solder. Use plenty and let it cool down. Okay, and now grab your heat shrink. Yeah, just put it over it like so. I'm going to do this with my hot air gun, because otherwise the thing will burn down. Ta-da! So now that's fixed. I think that these are okay tight. Now push your newly created ground wire onto the connector. If you want, you can glue it in place. That might be a good idea, actually. So let's glue the wire in place. While still maintaining the connector functionality part, I'm hoping. Like that. Wait for it to dry. And start putting this back together. So hopefully have a working product. Oh, first we need to put on the case cover in the correct orientation, obviously. Like so. And remove, that's very important, remove the remove after washing sticker from the beeper. So, put this back. It's just supposed to click back together like so. Don't forget to insert the screw at the bottom. And if you prefer so, you can also clip on the handle, but I think I prefer it like this. Now, there are a few questions right now that are in my head. The first being, will it explode when we power it up? I hope not. Second being, will my fuse box trigger? I hope. I'm just still going to attach it for this video. I think it's a little bit better. Check this. Oop. So, now it's turned off. Here we go. Everything is still on, but let me turn on the actual power switch at the back. Whoa. It worked. Screen's on, but the main question is, did it solve the problem with the connection between the ground and the wires of the mains connection? So let's check that, shall we? Well, this is one of the improvements that you can do yourself to this device to make it more to make it safer to work with, to operate it. Now I will make a video about how to connect the signal generator to your Siglent oscilloscope very soon. And yeah, let me know if you've got any ideas for this device that you want to see me do and perform on the channel. I hope to see you in the next video where I attach this to my my Siglent oscilloscope to do some cool stuff to make my Siglent oscilloscope think that this is a Siglent AWG. Please stay tuned on my channel. Please subscribe if you haven't already, because you won't miss out the upgrade of this thing in the future. And as always, thanks for watching and see you guys in the next one. Hey guys, this is Tim. I hope you liked that video. If you want to see more, please make sure to subscribe. You can also share the video with your friends and hit that like button. I'll see you in the next one.